I think it would be worthwhile to look at three key areas. One is, as Prime Minister, the primary issues, the challenges that you faced, and how you dealt with the issues, exercised leadership on those issues, and getting the country to face up and deal with some pretty tough realities. Then, as post-Prime Minister, working on international issues, apartheid in South Africa, Kosovo, your role in dealing with some of these very difficult and problematic concerns, and also to bring it back to Australia on some of the leadership issues and challenges for Australia, without talking specifically about the politicians, but more the issues that the country needs to address. Anything else in that, Ronnie?
That would be terrific. I think what's going to be very helpful for, you know, our aim is to generate stories and insights from your experience that will be useful to future leaders, and the people who come through here and the people who train and educate. And I think actually sometimes what's most helpful to people are a little tactical details, you know. I decided to talk to this person before that person, and this is why I thought strategically about these problems. Things that would be intuitive to you, that would be illuminating to other people as they develop their intuitions, will be quite helpful. And so if we end up spending quite a bit of time on one or two stories or one or two cases from your experience, and to go into those into some depth of those stories might turn out to be, in fact, more useful than if we stay sort of at the general level of trying to capture a whole career, which obviously we could never do justice to, even if we had a week.
That's right.
Okay, very good. Well, let's go back in time. And, I mean, you had a very successful win in 1975 and became the Prime Minister of Australia. Now, and it was a very kind of tough period you went through, and eventually there you are, you're the Prime Minister of the country. As you, I'm putting you back in November 1975, you've got the job, your party has won. Mm. What were the challenges that, as you looked out into the country, given that, yes, there is still opposition and still worry and concern and anger in some quarters about what transpired, but still the election was giving certainly a stamp, a vote of confidence to you and your government. How did it feel? What was it like at that very precarious place at that particular time?
Well, there was an enormous responsibility because the size of the majority demonstrated, I think, the depth of concern right across Australia. People mightn't have liked the dismissal as such, but overwhelmingly people wanted to get rid of the government, the previous government. You know, it's almost impossible to believe or understand in today's terms and norms, but in the two previous years the government had increased expenditure by 46% 1 year over the year before, and the next year after that by over 22%. Now, economic writers would totally condemn, I think everyone would totally condemn any government that tried to do that today. We'd also had the oil shock, I think 1974, wasn't it?
Yep.
And that hit Australia very hard. So coupled with the policies of government, business was in a state of decay, inflation was very high, and I suppose we had to do two things. We had to demonstrate clearly that we were going to govern fairly for everyone in the community, but we had to get our economic house in order. So long before President Reagan and long before Margaret Thatcher became Prime Minister, we began the task of educating the community to accepting that we had to cut expenditure and cut it very hard. Now, business didn't like this initially. They said, oh, the heavy industry people would say, oh, yes, cut it in every area, but not in areas that affect us. My treasurer and myself, for the first 18 months of government, whenever we made public speeches, we were saying, we have to cut expenditure, these are the reasons why.
Yeah.
Remember also that through the 50s and 60s, a number of governments had abused Keynesian type principles and thought that, you know, deficit financing is all right. If you spend money, you'll solve a problem. Yeah. Now, Keynes would have been horrified at the way his name was taken in vain by many countries and many governments in that period.
Yeah.
And people had forgotten that he had written for the circumstances of the world depression in the 1930s.
Yeah.
But so we had to change the environment. We had to change the way people looked at government. Government responsibilities, what governments could do.
Why was that important to do? I mean, your predecessor, Gough Whitlam, there was excessive social spending. People didn't quite know. Is this a period of enlightenment in Australia? Or, as you rightly point out, the excessive spending of government was actually having an economic drain on the country.
Yeah.
And so here you are in this role of trying to shift people's perception and understanding of what government is about, what it can do, what it should be attending to. Did you draw a lot of heat for it? You talked about from the business community.
There was a fair bit of heat from a lot of quarters, simply because we had to cut expenditure quite dramatically.
Yeah.
And not quite across the board. We tried to protect weaker members in society. And we also, we never said the economic bottom line is the only thing that matters.
Right.
If it was possible to introduce social reforms that were going to be meaningful and do it by readjusting finances, shifting from one area to another, then we made up our minds we would also do that, because governing for economics alone is not government.
Right.
That's being a straight-out accountant.
Right.
And governments are meant to do something more than that.
Yeah.
There was one very substantial social program that we acted upon very quickly in 1976. The old method of supporting families through the tax system helped wealthy people who were paying high rates,
right,
and gave absolutely no help to quite a lot of poorer families whose incomes just weren't high enough to get the advantage of the tax deduction.
Right.
So we used the same amount of money, but shifted it to a question of direct payments to families,
right,
or to mothers, actually.
Right. Yeah.
And this was regarded at the time as a major social advance. And being prepared to act in those ways also made general programs of fiscal restraint much more acceptable to the general community than they might otherwise have been, because in the next election, when, because of the depth of the problems, because of the excess expenditure, because of the oil shock for which the government had not been responsible, but it still had a dramatic effect on us, it was going to take 2 or 3 years before things really turned round.
Yeah.
And our second election was in 1977, at the end of 77, and we were returned with the same, virtually the same majority. I think there was one seat or two seats difference.
Right.
And they were the two biggest majorities that any government has ever had in Australia.
Yeah.
So, there was support for the program.
What about the challenges in getting support for the program? And this kind of relates to kind of pacing the work out in the country, not overwhelming the country, because certainly you're talking about a significant shift, a departure in your form of governance from the previous government. Fiscal restraint and responsibility, new social programs. What were the, how many issues do you think you were able to actually work in the country, big issues, to keep alive, keep people's focus on, people's attention on, without overwhelming them or getting them disillusioned or frustrated or angry?
Well, quite a number. In the time of the previous government, I really believe people and journalists had, in a sense, become punch drunk.
Yeah.
So many, in my view, irresponsible things had happened that irresponsible actions were almost accepted as the norm. You know, there'd been a large number of ministers who'd had to resign or been forced out or who'd lied to their own prime minister or lied to the parliament. And the government was trying to borrow a large sum of money through the Middle East, through a weird intermediary, bypassing all the traditional sources.
Yeah.
And so all of this was in the public domain. And the best way of putting all that into perspective is we're a country which seeks net migration to Australia. Right. 1975 was the first year post-war in which more people left Australia than came to Australia.
Gee.
And I met people from Eastern Europe saying, look, we've seen this kind of decay happen in our own old country. We're not going to sit around and watch it happening here. We're going to try to go to Canada or the United States.
Yeah.
Now, that just underlines the importance or the seriousness of the situation in the public mind.
Uh-huh.
But the government has got to tackle a large number of issues. We had indigenous issues. In the previous 15 years, governments had started to introduce reasonable programs in relation to our indigenous population, but the question of land rights, which is not foreign to America or to Canada, had arisen. We introduced land rights legislation. We had to act on the environment, and we did so in ways that overrode some of the authority of the states, which is sensitive in the Australian context. But we felt that we ought to. There were serious issues in terms of uranium mining, and we managed to get the agreement of all the parties, environmentalists, indigenous people, our coalition partners, who are really a rural agrarian party, to mining in one of Australia's major national parks.
Kakadu?
Kakadu.
Right.
But we were able to do that because of a long process of negotiation and consultation. And then when that was over, a very careful program of explanation, we put together publicity packs for the media, but for anyone else who wanted them.
Yeah.
This is why it's important, this is why we're doing it. People were concerned about safety in uranium mining and trading, obviously. And we believed that if we entered the business, we could help to make sure that worldwide standards and procedures were the strictest that they could possibly be.
Yeah.
And we believed that if we didn't, other people in other countries who were also mining uranium would do so under circumstances which were less strict, less severe, therefore more potentially dangerous.
But was there any opposition to this?
Yes, there was, but it took, I think, about 18 months to get agreement. And we had gone into it so thoroughly, the environmental factors, the safety factors, that what we did was accepted.
Yeah.
And if there's a message in that, it is, if you've got a potentially, well, a serious issue, which is potentially extraordinarily divisive, well, then a process of consultation, a process of reason, listening to people, trying to address their specific concerns, is essential to be able to carry the policy matter forward.
And who are the primary stakeholders and constituents you're interacting with there? There's obviously
The companies that wanted to market, all the environmental groups because it was in Kakadu National Park, Aboriginal groups because it was in land that was basically their land, and we wanted their agreement to the process. There was obviously a financial inducement because very significant royalties went in their direction as a consequence.
Yeah.
But the you know, we have a coalition government, so the National Party had to be happy with it, the Liberal Party had to be happy with it. It was really the environmental groups and the Aboriginal groups, and then the special one-interest anti-uranium mining groups,
right,
that had to, if not be brought fully on side, at least neutralised so that they couldn't frustrate the policy.
Is that the thrill of the ride in the exercise of leadership, is taking on a very difficult, problematic issue like this and really beginning to work it? Initially, when you take it on, you don't know what the outcome is going to be. You don't know, or do you? Or do you have a sense of exactly where you are going?
I knew where I wanted to go. On that issue, I felt that we're going to be able to achieve it. It's going to take some time. But I thought the logic of the situation was so strong that in the end, opponents would accept what we were planning to do. There are some issues that arise. I can remember when President Carter and his original Camp David Accords, now the patrolling the ceasefire line between Israel and Egypt and the Sinai,
right,
was going to be an essential part of this activity.
Yeah.
I thought very strongly we should support Carter's initiative and those accords. It was a step forward in the Middle East. But the trade ministers in my government were very nervous of offending Arab states. Doug Anthony, my deputy prime minister in particular, had concerns, but others did also. And if I'd tried to force a decision through as soon as the United States asked us to support the thing, it was a question of providing a relatively small number of military. In the end, it ended up being a helicopter squadron to patrol the border. I think they're still there. I don't think I would have got it through cabinet. If I'd really made a row of it, I suppose I would have. But then I would have left wounded feelings, and your cabinet members wouldn't have felt fully committed to the policy, which they needed to be if it was to be sustainable.
Mm.
But then Sadat was assassinated.
Right.
Anthony was in the Middle East at the time, and so I said, Doug, I can't get away, you go to Sadat's funeral.
Right.
And a number of people spoke to him, obviously, and so he rang me and he said, would I list the Sinai Camp David Accords for the cabinet agenda when he came back? And I said, yes, very happily. Why? He said, we've got to support it, Malcolm, we've got to support it. Yeah. The whole place is going to blow up. We have to support it. And so here I am. You know, my trade minister had turned around completely.
Yeah.
And with his support, there wasn't going to be a problem. But
You used events as educative moments, as teaching moments, to shift attitudes.
We used events to shift attitudes, but we also did something else, because it wasn't a United Nations activity, and still is not a United Nations activity. And we didn't know who the other participants, they couldn't be American because they would have been, they'd been sort of party principal or major intermediaries in the agreement. It needed to be people at arm's length to the actual negotiating process. And we wanted to be there with respectable partners.
Right.
And President Carter was looking for support from four or five countries in total. So the British weren't keen, the French weren't keen, the Germans, they would have been the wrong people at that time anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So we didn't just make a decision, yes, we'll do it, we'll provide our share of the military force. We said, yes, we'll do it, so long as a major European state is also involved in the in providing troops and forces. And we made this public, And I told President Carter at the time that we've couched the decision in these terms, quite deliberately, to strengthen his arm in negotiating with the British and the French so he could twist. And I can remember the British getting on to me and saying, why did I do this? I said, because I want you to be there.
Yeah.
But you're making it impossible for us to refuse. We didn't want to be there.
Right.
I said, well, that's fine. I've achieved my objective. and it's not often that a country Australia's size can, by a important public decision, strengthen the negotiating arm of the United States.
Yeah.
But
how do you choose what issues there, internationally or domestically, to work on? I mean, there's sometimes the immediate issue, the pressing issue, the opportunity avails itself. You make an educated choice. Yeah, we'll take this on. We'll work at this. Is an important issue. There must be other issues that, internationally and domestically, where you're saying, well, the country or other players out there in the international stage are not really ready for it, but we need to plug away at it to get it to be eventually to a stage where people can accept it, can work on it.
Well, it depends what the issue is. The first thing you do, I believe, is to look around for allies. Who is going to support the objective that you want to achieve? And again, to give an example, I very strongly believe that East and Southeast Asia needed to build up its own infrastructure, its own regional associations. We were then, and in many ways still are, the least organized region of some economic importance in the world.
Right.
You can't compare any organization to what happens in Europe. The United States has NAFTA, which presumably will encroach over the whole American hemisphere as time goes on.
Right.
In East and Southeast Asia, there is no equivalent. There's ASEAN, but that's limited in size. There's nothing that embraces all the countries from Japan, Australia, China, everyone in between. And I can remember discussing this with Prime Minister O'Hara when he came to Australia in 1980. We basically wanted to establish an organization that would promote freer trade between the whole region. And we wanted an organization that might ultimately grow to encompass security aspects and through its processes enable national leaders to discuss matters that were of particular importance or relevance to the region as a whole. But there was no framework in which this could be done. Now, if we'd come out and said we want to promote APEC right from the beginning, ASEAN would have objected. You're trying to take us over. You're trying to make ASEAN of no importance.
Right.
So ASEAN countries, especially Indonesia, had to be persuaded that what we were trying to do would not weaken their role. It would, if anything, strengthen all the ASEAN countries, because they'd be also not only ASEAN, but part of a larger grouping designed to promote interests and security trade within the region. So with Prime Minister here, we decided, well, we'll establish an international forum. It'll be non-governmental, but there'll be bureaucrats at it, there'll be academics at it, there'll be business people at it, and it will have meetings quite regularly in different parts. And we had a meeting in Jakarta, which was, I think, significant in bringing Indonesia alongside in terms of the larger objective.
And was that difficult, kind of getting these countries like Indonesia? Did you personally have to be sitting down with Suharto and saying, listen, you need to be thinking about this, or Lee Kuan Yew, or whatever?
No, I think we got people from different arenas. We pulled in our academic networks, the business networks, and we made it plain to governments what we were wanting to do, and we also wanted government officials to be involved, principally from either prime ministers or presidential departments, or from foreign affairs and trade. But it wasn't until several years later that this process had so advanced, the opposition had been overcome, people thought, yes, this is a good idea, and then my successor, Bob Hawke, proposed APEC to countries of the region. Now, Bob Hawke was correct in the initial proposal, it was East and Southeast Asia. But unfortunately, the United States said, you can't do this without us, and very severely lobbied all the Asian countries,
yeah.
saying that they would incur American displeasure
yeah.
if they went ahead. America had to be involved. In fact, they wanted it to be a Pan-Pacific organization.
Yeah.
So instead of responding to the needs of East and Southeast Asia, it is now mixed up with Canada, America, Central American countries, obviously Mexico and others, and South American countries all bordering the Pacific. So APEC has become so large and so diffuse
yeah.
that it can't respond to the needs of East and Southeast Asia as I'd originally intended, as a hero had, and as Bob Hawke did when he promoted it.
So what happened? Does it just get out of hand?
Well, no, APEC has been reasonably successful in keeping countries or persuading countries that they should continue to open their trade market.
Right.
Markets. But, you know, there's a clear conflict. Canada and America, Mexico, NAFTA.
Yeah.
None of us can join NAFTA.
Yeah.
I don't think any of us would really want to unless the whole region could.
Right.
So there is still a remaining need to establish forums in which countries of East and Southeast Asia will really sit down together and discuss issues that are of importance to them. The economic crisis of 97, I think, is bringing this process forward.
Yeah.
There's a distrust of international institutions, of the IMF, too much under the influence of legislators in Washington.
Yeah.
Too dependent upon American money.
Yeah.
Japan has proposed there should be an Asian Monetary Fund, and if you had China, Japan, other countries, including Australia, putting in resources, we'd have enough resources to make an effective instrument.
Yeah.
But it was the whole idea initially was one which was good, but it was before its time.
Yeah.
Because too many players in the region would not have been prepared to accept the idea of a total regional organization.
But you started something there, and
we started something, and it went on.
Yeah.
And it became successful. And
yeah.
The only disappointment for me, and it was, I know, for Hawke, was that it was not able to fulfill the purely regional role which we thought was important.
Yeah.
But as a trade organization encompassing all the countries of the Pacific, it has been useful.
Right. I want us to talk about your work in recent years and since 1983, particularly with South Africa and Kosovo, Yugoslavia and what have you. But before we get, what is it like actually being a prime minister? I mean, having that amount of authority, are there real constraints? I mean, you're getting attacked by the opposition, and we have a very vehement opposition in Australia. The press is certainly not always on your side and attack you from every direction. It's got to be extremely difficult to be able to hold steady, focus on an issue, keep the issue going under that kind of attack on an ongoing, constant basis. Well, I mean, what's it like?
Well, I think, putting it bluntly, that's just part of politics.
That's politics.
I mean, it's always like that, but it's a question of knowing what you want to do, having a judgment of what Australians will expect, what they will respect.
Yeah.
Not only expect, respect.
Yeah.
They mightn't like something in the immediate term, but if you can persuade them that it's to the advantage of the country, they will accept it, they will support it. There were one aspect of my government's affairs that never got much publicity at the time, it's had more publicity since, is a constant theme throughout the whole 7 years of the promotion of human rights, whether in Australia or abroad. Yeah. Now, the land rights legislation for Aboriginals was promoting human rights for Aboriginals. Yeah. The Ombudsman, the Administrative Appeals Tribunal, the Human Rights Commission, established in 1980. But not only that, we'd had, which I'm sure you'd understand, but a lot of your students probably wouldn't, up to the beginning of the World War, Australia was dominantly white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, and if you didn't come out of that mould, you probably should pretend to be regarded as a good Australian, even though we had a very large Irish Catholic minority.
Right.
There were extreme religious divisions, which went back to the First World War and the way certain conscription issues were handled, which had led to very bitter sectarian problems between Catholics and the rest, Irish and the rest, which weren't ended till the middle 1950s. But putting that aside, after the war, Australia had decided that we really did need to have a much larger population. We needed to be able to do something to develop and defend our own country. We'd been very vulnerable, and it was almost an accident that we weren't invaded.
Yeah.
A very fortunate one, obviously.
By the Japanese, you mean, right?
By the Japanese, yes. But it was the battles of the Midway, battles of the Coral Sea. Yeah. Those battles could have gone either way. There was no clear-cut victory in any case. But it did stall the Japanese invasion fleet, which was already on the waters. So when the migration program began, government and opposition hoped that, you know, for every alien, which meant non-British, you'd have 10 people from Britain. It never worked out that way. Overwhelming the majority of people came from Europe, Eastern Europe, Southern Europe, as a refugee migration turned to an economic migration. And so the face of Australia was being very steadily but substantially changed.
Right.
Nobody ever had a referendum and said, do you support some hundreds of thousands of Italians or Greeks coming here or people from Eastern Europe? If you ever conducted that sort of vote, I think overwhelmingly any country would vote against it.
Right.
So it's a question of governments having to say, this is in the national interest, this is what we've got to do, and explaining why.
Yeah.
And then people accept it.
It's not just explaining it, there's also this teaching component to educate them, to help them.
Well, this was very much so. And in those days, there was something called a Population Planning Council, an Immigration Advisory Council, which were groups of private citizens who supported the objective and whose role was to make sure that the public debate in relation to migration was won. But now, in my time, a new component was added to all of this. We'd been involved, unfortunately, because it ended in failure, in the Vietnam conflict in support of South Vietnam and the United States. Now, there were tens upon tens of thousands of South Vietnamese and later people from Cambodia also, across Indochina, with whom we'd worked. They believed they had assurances, if not from us, certainly from the United States. And we certainly believed that after 1975, when it all ultimately collapsed, that they would be very much in danger.
Yeah.
So, what do you do? On past practices, they probably wouldn't have been given refugee status in Australia, but I just said to our immigration minister, we have no honourable option. And so, over time, over 200,000 people from Indochina came to Australia, and this was a new component in widening and broadening.
Yeah. What was the reaction of Australians, white Australians at that time?
We never made a major statement about it. We never made a major fuss about it.
Yeah.
They had a very good immigration minister who was able to... Nothing was hidden.
Right.
But he handled the issue, very delicately.
Yeah.
And I was never conscious of any significant opposition.
Yeah.
It was accepted, and so by the 1980s, we'd really had a major influx of people from Asia, and that, of course, to a greater or lesser extent, continues.
Right.
But it also showed that there would be problems if you had Australians or a significant number wanting to say, you know, you've still got to behave like an Anglo-Saxon.
Yeah.
So we developed, we appointed an official inquiry and developed policies which come under the broad heading of multiculturalism.
Yeah.
So we encourage diversity. We don't say to people, you've got to forget your land of origin. You can still love its history, its traditions, and you can still make sure your kids understand this and understand your native language. And this all becomes part of Australia.
Yeah.
Now, there were a lot of people at the time saying, well, you know, this is placing Greece or Vietnam over and above loyalty to Australia, but it wasn't.
Yeah.
It was just saying to people, you don't have to cut out your past, you don't have to be ashamed of your country of origin.
Yeah.
You will still have relatives there, and you'll still probably have a great affection, but you just want to make Australia a country to which your primary obligation and loyalty lies.
Yeah, and Australia today is certainly very multicultural.
And we're totally multicultural.
Yeah.
Now, the current government established an inquiry to see whether the term multicultural should be or should not be used. And it came out very unequivocally saying, yes, of course it should be used.
Yeah.
Although our Prime Minister, I still think, has not once used the term.
Yeah, they don't use it anymore.
Everyone else uses the term.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if I'm looking in retrospect at whatever my government was able to achieve,
yeah,
I think establishing the principle of multiculturalism,
yeah,
embedding that deeply in the Australian psyche so that it can't be rubbed out, you can't turn the clock back.
Yeah, and certainly you've had some people try to turn the clock back in.
Some have, yeah.
Recently,
you embedded it in part through action. Because
well, we embedded it, yes.
You brought in 200,000 people without making a big public fuss, but then their presence would be felt and would serve as a attitude shaping.
Well, it did, and the community leaders themselves did a great job in influencing and educating the press, the media, their local communities, their local government, that issues that were of importance to them were legitimate issues for public debate and discussion in Australia.
I mean, you created facts on the ground.
We created a whole range of programs regarding post-arrival services for migrants to Australia, which should have actually happened 30 years earlier. And this, part of this was just simply English language training, which was easily accessible. You get problems. The husband learns English at work. The kids learn English at school. Mum stays at home, in those days anyway, has nobody to talk to, can't understand what's happening on the radio.
Yeah.
And so how do the wives
get
integrated? And so we supported local community groups, ethnic community groups. The success of this is really measured by what's happened in the last two or three years since the Kosovo wars.
Right.
Because we had, I was in Croatia on one occasion, and somebody said, "Hi, Mel," and I looked around, and all I could see was a youngster in a Croatian Air Force uniform, and he was the Australian who'd said, "Hi, how are you?" And he'd gone and signed up for 2 years to help Croatia. Now, we've had, there would be some Serbs from Australia, there would be Albanians, there's certainly Croatians, all of whom would have gone back to fight with their different racial groups or ethnic groups in the Balkans. But they do it there.
Yeah.
They don't import
these
problems into Australia. And an overriding message throughout this whole process has been that problems in ancient lands, however much you might like those or love your land of origin, their problems must not be imported into Australia. And that has, in all cases, been accepted by the ethnic community leaders.
Yeah.
And I think I...
And it's been an explicit message.
Oh, it's been a very explicit message.
Quite explicit.
Yes.
But you've also continued to carry that message and work that message in Australia. We've seen the rise and fall of Pauline Hanson, and since I was living in Brisbane, kind of observed that firsthand in Queensland and see it spread throughout Australia. But I never really noticed or saw the government of Australia in over the last 5 years attend to that issue directly head on and make a statement in regards to Australia as a multicultural country and its future. And so this right-wing populism has had an ugly face at times, but you've certainly taken a stand. You've spoken to those concerns and the issues, be it migration, Aboriginal issues and rights. Did you feel there was a real opening, an obligation to fill the void, to speak to that, to keep, to ensure that we don't take 10 steps backwards?
I really was appalled at my own party not acting on these issues. The government kept on saying that, oh, it's not important, it's not significant, nobody in Asia notices it. But shortly after Pauline Hanson had arisen, well, after the Queensland election where she got a large vote, she's not necessarily politically dead, by the way.
She seems to be rising.
She'll be influencing events in this next federal election, I think. But I was in China, I was talking with Zhu Rongji, and he said, Mr. Fraser is an old friend of China, I feel I can ask you, tell me about Pauline Hanson. His second question was, well, you know, that's my judgment also of what Pauline Hanson is about, from what I've been told from her own people. But why then does not Prime Minister Howard condemn her?
Yeah.
I mean, the silence had been noted and is noted.
Yeah.
And her reputation has slipped through Asia, not just because of her, for other reasons also. But, you know, when, to me, Pauline Hanson isn't all racism.
Economic issues.
There were economic issues.
Yeah.
The regions of Australia, because of drought and low rural prices, had felt totally neglected by all the major political parties.
Yeah.
Along comes Pauline Hanson, who's saying a lot of populist things, some of which they like to hear. Mixed up with that are racist remarks about Indigenous people and also about others.
Yeah.
But she's a vehicle by which people were able to kick the major parties in the backside and kick them good and hard. Because they had been made to feel irrelevant, government services had been withdrawn from their areas at a time of real rural poverty. Not many people realize that through a lot of these years there were a group of women in Toowoomba, which is a major regional city in Queensland, not far from Brisbane, who were sending food parcels to the properties and people in central and western Queensland because they couldn't afford to pay grocery bills. And that went on for 2 or 3 years.
One of the issues that she did raise was the economic issues and globalization, which has many meanings, but and certainly she worked that issue in a way that the negative sides of it, the consequences for rural Australia, the consequences for Australian industry, and certainly Australia, some states more than others, had adopted free market strategies, privatization, selling off state assets, maybe going a little bit too fast. So the population wasn't aware of really what's going on, not informed, didn't really understand it. What's your take on that, particularly as Prime Minister up until today, on how Australia has handled globalization, free markets, privatization, and how could it have been done better, or what's the work that needs to be done there now?
Well, how could it have been done better? You've really got to go back, in my view, to the middle 1980s. In the middle 1980s, the government of that day reduced protection four times more than we needed to comply absolutely with the provisions of the Uruguay Round. Now, trade is a bargain. We've amalgamated foreign affairs and trade into one department. Foreign affairs are the people who want everyone else to love them. I think you need the hard men, and the hard men should be in a separate trade department with a separate minister who knows how to build up trade alliances and strengthen Australia's negotiating capacity. And but when we reduced protection so heavily in the middle 1980s, we didn't do it gaining commensurate advantage in anyone else's market. We just said, here, we're innocent, we're virginal, yeah. Everyone else come and join us.
Yeah.
No, everyone else went and laughed at us.
Yeah.
Nobody is going to give anything away easily on trade. And if we give other people a benefit in our market without first of all saying, well, what benefit are we going to get in your market? Well, then we're doing our own selves a grave disservice. So that aspect, I think, was handled badly, and I think the trade aspects have not been handled well, very significantly because of the philosophy underlying the combined Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade.
Yeah.
The other issues in older times, which is only going back 20 years, if there was very significant foreign investment in this country, in Australia, we'd say that foreign investment should bring some benefit to Australia. Now, the benefit might be establishing a new enterprise, bringing in new technology. It could be taking over Australian operation, but expanding it, improving it, modernizing it, and whatever. Now, those rules in relation to foreign investment, which nobody seemed to mind all that much, have all been abolished. Anyone is allowed to buy anything. And
like any multinational or international company can come and just buy what it wants in Australia.
I mean, there's a Foreign Investment Review Board, and they've got a couple of cases in front of them now. It'll be interesting to see how they run.
Yeah.
Shell buying off major Australian natural gas operations in the Northwest Shelf off the coast of Western Australia. But broadly, with the exception of the banks, anything can buy anything.
Yeah.
And that means that a number of really very good top-flight Australian companies of different kinds have been bought by foreigners, and National Mutual, a major life insurance policy, is now French AXA.
Yeah.
But French AXA haven't contributed anything. All they've done is taken over an Australian icon.
Yeah.
And you could cite example after example of this.
Yeah.
Now, the consequences of that, if allowed to go on, will mean that we are not going to have a major Australian corporation being a major and dominant player in any industry area.
Yeah.
Because we're approaching 20 million people. There will always be somebody outside who can pay more for a good Australian asset than somebody inside Australia.
Yeah.
And when our dollar is a miserable 47 or 48 cents, it makes every Australian asset a dirt cheap grab for somebody from America or Britain or Germany or Japan or whatever.
Yeah.
And I don't think governments can continue with a policy which says, well, the market will fix it.
Yeah.
I really don't.
And do you think they're buying into that ideology, a free market ideology, and leaving it to the free markets and not keeping their eye on the ball?
At the moment, it's left with rare exceptions where the Foreign Investment Review Board does make your recommendations to the Treasurer. It's basically left to straight market forces.
Yeah.
The markets don't always make sensible or rational decisions.
Yeah.
I think they've run the Australian dollar down beyond reason at the present moment, but that's the market. There was a, to give an example, in Mr. Reagan's time, President Reagan, when the yen-dollar ratio was fixed at 1 to 250, Japan and the States agreed that they would float their currencies because they thought the dollar was, or America thought the dollar was overvalued. But they thought it was overvalued about 10%. Over the next 18 months, the dollar-yen ratio fell until it was 1 to 110. So the value of the dollar was more than halved. Nobody, not then, not today, thinks that was a rational market response. But it's what the market does. And are we, you know, I used to enjoy coming to the, America in the late 70s or early 80s when I'd get about $1.20 American for an Australian dollar. I don't enjoy coming here today and getting 47 cents for an Australian dollar.
The dollar doesn't go very far.
And in the, if you look at strong economies around the world, no country has really, certainly no middle-ranking country, has run an effective and strong economy with a continually depreciating currency. And nobody in Australia is focusing on what needs to be done to start to strengthen the Australian currency once again. And I think nobody is looking at it, because it might mean some interference with the total free market globalization process. But there are a lot of other countries looking at this issue also. It's not only an issue for Australia.
What are the various costs? It sounds to me that the cost of not only economic, but also social identity, when you talk about there will be no Australian, great Australian company in any industry eventually, the loss that I sense you're describing is not only an economic loss, it's a loss of something having to do with national, with nationhood. Can you describe what are the various externalities of this process? What are the, what may be difficult for economists to identify as relevant because they're not quantifiable, but to you they may seem quite essential to the welfare and well-being of the national culture. Can you describe what some of those are that people ought to be paying attention to?
I think self-esteem, respect for your own nation, pride in your own country. If you know, a major mining company, BHP, has recently done a merger deal, and it's with Billiton. Nobody's quite sure which company is going to come out on top at the end of the day, but they are saying the headquarters of BHP Billiton will stay in Australia. But I think the consequences...
will the company be less responsive to community concerns?
Well, this is one part of the problem with the globalization process, because you get to the stage where only the United States or only the European community, if it acts as a cohesive whole, can tackle the authority and power of these major countries. I mean, Microsoft has been under attack in this country, but no other country worldwide could have attacked Microsoft for the same reasons, even if it had been, you know, headquartered somewhere else. No other country would have been big enough to start the process. And if we're going inexorably to the stage where corporations are going to continue to amalgamate, get larger and larger, they are going to be more remote from any immediate community, less responsive to the immediate needs of consumers. They'll certainly be responsive to shifts in their profit making. But again, a middle-ranking country is going to be left powerless in these circumstances. I mean, our purchasing community is not going to be large enough to affect a major conglomerate. The combined purchasing community in the United States or the European community would be large enough. So if Nike or somebody offended all America by the way it produces its products, although I think it's actually tried to reform its processes very considerably in recent times. But just using that as an example, Australia can't have an impact on that. The United States can. Now, are we headed for a world where not only military power, scientific power and knowledge and capacity, and broad-based economic power resides in the United States and much greater than anywhere else, but are we heading for a world in which major corporations will only have to pay attention to United States law because the laws of any other country are not going to be effective, and a country like Australia would really be impotent, too small to affect the processes. Now, I don't think anyone in the globalization process has really thought this through as to where it's going to lead. And the to me, the demonstrations in Seattle and whatever were in part at least sponsored by a feeling of powerlessness amongst general communities.
Yes.
Something is taking over in the world, authority is being removed from governments.
Yeah.
Too many political leaders have said, well, this is globalization, we have to ride with it. And people don't like a situation in which they think that they can no longer influence the strings of power.
I think also part of the concern, certainly in Australia, and as an Australian, I don't have any sense of future. Like, people are actually speaking about the future, what the future could be. And so, therefore, issues like globalization or in Australia, it's somewhat of an identity crisis as they're grappling with issues. Do we become a republic, not a republic? Indigenous reconciliation issues. Without that sense of future of what we're going into, somebody speaking to that and providing some degree of possibility, inspiration or vision, whatever terminology we use, you get preoccupied with kind of immediate concerns without any concern about the implication of failing to attend to it or attending to it in a particular way.
Well, nobody in the political process is really talking about longer term issues.
Mm.
The Labour Party has made some policy decisions which point to a longer term concern. They've said that the migration program should be built up, expanded significantly.
Yeah.
They haven't put a number on it, but at least they've said it should be built up, which is, in my view, much better than a program that continues to shrink.
Yeah.
But nobody is saying, well, where will Australia stand in 2020, 2025, 2050? Yeah. And I think we should be trying to define what sort of country we would like to be by 2050.
Yeah.
And here there's a stark contrast to, which I think doesn't only affect Australia, I think it might affect the United States to an extent, and certainly European countries. In the immediate post-war years, all our leaders had been through the war. We'd witnessed what had happened. We'd known about the Holocaust. People had been through the Depression. There were many countries with 20 or 30% unemployment. They'd been through the trade restrictions and protectionism of those years. And at the end of the war, there were very serious people, especially in Britain and the United States, who sat down and said, you know, how do we build a better world? And this was, in a sense, an age of international liberalism.
Mm.
We not only had the Bretton Woods instruments and the idealism that underlay the UN, the World Bank, and the International Monetary Fund, but the idealism of those years, I think, has been lost.
Yeah.
And the sense of imperative on leaders of major states in those years, which drove them to trying to build something better,
yeah,
does not exist in today's leaders.
Yeah.
And they haven't had the same experiences. After all, it's 50 years since the end of the war.
Since those more catastrophes.
55 years. And, and so it's only history to young people today. It's only history to most leaders today. And in Australia, people sat down and said, we have, it was a not necessarily a good term, but populate or perish.
Right.
We had 7 million people at the end of the war. And everyone knew that we'd been within an ace of invasion. And, you know, if Japan had not done us a kind deed by attacking Pearl Harbor, we almost certainly would have been invaded.
Yeah.
So they said, how do we make Australia more secure? How do we strengthen Australia? Well, the first leg of that had to be a major migration program, which continued for the best part of 30 years. But there were many other things that had to be done. We needed a high savings rate. I can remember that in the 50s we all made speeches about the need not to enjoy all the results of our labours today, but we had to save, we had to invest so that Australia would be a better and a stronger country for our kids in future years.
Yeah.
We had one of the highest savings rates in the world in the 50s and 60s. We had high growth, low inflation. We also paid our own way. Paying our own way was an article of faith.
Yeah.
Defending the value of the Australian dollar, what was then the pound, was an article of faith. Any government that didn't defend the value of its own currency deserved to be put into the ash can, because it was like robbing all... I mean, every Australian today has been robbed of half his net worth.
Yeah.
By the fall in the dollar over the last several years, if you're judging that net worth in worldwide terms. And so in the late 40s and 50s, people were really saying, you know, what do we need to do? And there was a sense of commitment, a sense of purpose. Now, that doesn't exist today.
Yeah.
But
this is quite interesting, because the impetus for long-term thinking was a major world catastrophe.
Mm.
First economic, and then war.
Yeah.
In the absence of an event that then forces the question before people, a question that's quite complex, that doesn't have quite as a clear an answer as one, as any leader might like, but at least the question itself is critically important, you're saying.
The question is, I don't think the question today is as difficult.
As it was then?
No, I don't think then it was difficult. In the late 40s and 50s, it was clear enough what we ought to do. And part of what we did then, because the Cold War was very real, there's a serious communist insurgency in Malaya that went on for over 10 years, and we were involved with others and helping Malaya to put that down. The communist coup in Indonesia failed by 20 seconds. If Nasution, the PKI, I knew Aidit, but he was bright and sharp as a button. And when he made his move, what they intended to do was to kill all the leading generals who might be able to marshal the Indonesian forces. One escaped, Nasution, and he got out his bathroom window as the assassins for Nasution came in his front door. And he was able to get away, and he was able to muster the military, and they put down that coup in a pretty rugged and bloody fashion. But it was a very near thing. If he'd slept for another 30 seconds and hadn't got out, Indonesia might have become communist. And what would we have felt then? Now, this is so remote to today's world that, that people want to see, but it was the, also part of the environment which made Australians determined to build, to strengthen, to broaden the base of their own country. And again, we don't have that imperative. Nobody fears communism, nobody fears the Soviet Union. It doesn't exist.
So one still has to find events to generate the impetus for raising these questions. For example, the end of the Vietnam War and the need to do something about those 200,000 people served as an event that also helped you open the doors of immigration to an array of racial groups and ethnic groups that had heretofore not been welcome in Australia.
Well, only in very small numbers.
Right. So that event was a mechanism that helped you move a larger agenda of human rights forward domestically. What current events can politicians in Australia use to raise some of the future-oriented questions that otherwise there's no urgency and you can't draw attention?
Well, some of the events are difficult to mention because of very real sensitivities with our neighbors. It's of paramount importance to the whole region that Indonesia hang together as a nation. As a result of the way the Timor issues were handled, there's no guarantee that it will hang together. The political processes are not strong. President Wahid was very deliberately chosen as a Muslim to try and make sure that radical Islam didn't gain a strong foothold in Indonesia, and I think he might have been successful in that.
Yeah.
But there are still breakaway movements in different countries or different parts of Indonesia which are serious and which in today's world they're going to find it very difficult to handle. There are a number of different ethnic groups, and we need to understand that the unifying factor for Indonesia was that it had all been part of the Dutch Empire. Apart from that, it's not in the sense a totally natural country in terms of its ethnic makeup. But if Indonesia did fall apart, and it's difficult for political leaders to speculate aloud about this, it's not hard to see how security concerns through our whole region would be handled.
Yeah.
You could, for Australia, have the most acute difficulty of hundreds of thousands of boat people arriving on our northern shores. And if our immigration minister can't handle 3,000 or 4,000 without making the fuss he makes, how would he react? How would Australia react?
Yeah.
Because in today's world, a lot of these people, I think, fleeing often the most terrible tyrannies from Afghanistan or Iraq or whatever, have been demonized, and wrongly so, in the Australian context. Most of them ultimately end up with official refugee status.
You haven't yet experienced a major Muslim immigration, then, as you have experienced a Buddhist or a Hindu.
I think there are probably more Muslims in Australia than Jews.
So you have. So this would not be new then.
Which is, no, not completely new. No. But a more serious circumstance, which would, without the clearest government lead, heavily. Let me put it this way. For 50 years, as part of the British Empire, we probably thought we were safe because wherever the map was read, the British would be able to defend us and protect us. Well, that all went out the window in the World War, and it certainly went out the window. I mean, Britain had a useful role in decolonizing Malaysia and Singapore, and they did that very responsibly, and in ways in which I think was appreciated. But then they withdrew from east of Aden, and then they've withdrawn from Aden, and they're overstretched in Ireland almost, and in the European concerns. So that linkage is totally
right.
Defunct in terms of local cooperation. It's been replaced by ANZUS and the relationship with the United States, which has been and is a very strong one. Now, I always believed that ANZUS would be a an effective instrument for the defence of Australia if Australia were attacked. The only possible attack or conceivable attack would have been an ideological one based on communism. And the United States strongly opposed the spread of communism, and therefore it would be in her interests to help Australia in those circumstances.
Yeah.
But put communism aside, what interest has the United States in helping to defend Australia against some other attack that is not necessarily ideological? So therefore, what use is ANZUS to us in today's world?
Yeah.
Our defense people love the so-called secret information that they think they get, and access to superior military equipment, which they do get, but not superior to that, I'm sure, which the Americans would be making available to NATO allies and all the rest.
But if Indonesia falls apart, I thought you were describing that as a, not a military threat to Australia, but that your shores would be awash with immigrants, with poor people, with frightened people, and that it would then be a an economic and a cultural challenge domestically to Australia.
Well, that's one. I was really moving on and leading to another,
okay.
Which is probably a more significant threat than anything that might come out of Indonesia, because I know people disagree as to the extent to which people would try and emigrate from Indonesia. There'd be a great deal of internal fighting, a great deal of internal chaos, but how many would seek to then move to Malaysia or back to Indochina or south to Australia might be problematical, but it's a scenario which carries some credibility.
Sure.
With it.
Mm-hmm.
And people ought to be giving some thought, but it's not something you can really speak about publicly.
Yeah.
But the other issue, which does involve our relationship with the United States very, very severely, is Taiwan. And the thing I fear in our region, the growing independence movement in Taiwan, the prospect that you could have people from this country going to Taiwan and say, well, look, why don't you demand independence, really demand independence? We can get you support in the States. The Taiwan lobby has always been very strong. The religious right of the Republican Party, human rights, democratic left of the Democratic Party. In my view, and I'd like you to tell me that I'm totally wrong, because I'd be relieved, but could combine to say, well, if they want to be free, they should be able to be free. After all, they're democratic, and we should support democracies. But the Universal Declaration of Human Rights deliberately excluded the right of any group or people to break away and establish a separate state. Mm-hmm. That wasn't inadvertent, it wasn't accidental. It was regarded as essential for the maintenance of order in the international environment. But if that movement came in Taiwan, and if, as I believe, it could get significant support in the United States, and if that support were enough to change the policies of your president, and let me say, every president from Nixon to Clinton, his policy has been impeccable on this issue, his publicly stated policy. But then that's equivalent to a declaration of war with China, because this has to be read in the context of Western humiliations of China going back 100 years or more, well, going back much further, but continuing over a very long time span. China's not going to let that happen again. Then you look at what happens. All right, let's say there is a war, and let's say the Japanese are silly enough to respond under their Defense Cooperation Agreement and help the United States. And let's say we have an Australian administration that is foolish enough to go in the same direction, although with Japan there's meant to be an automatic trigger with us, where, you know, we can make a judgment at the time, but it's a much more open defense arrangement with the United States. But we have had senior Americans saying, when this happens, you've got to be with us, you've got to be doing your share of the dirty work. And I wish they'd said it to me, because I would have given them a much sharper answer than the one I know they got. But short of using nuclear weapons, and if that happens, the whole world's destroyed, because if that happens, what will Russia do? If Russia moves, what will NATO do? And you really run the risk of a nuclear holocaust.
Yeah.
So let's assume that America does not use nuclear weapons and China does not. And I don't think China would first, because her nuclear superiority or inferiority would be so very marked. But if America couldn't beat Vietnam, and America win that kind of conflict with China, they might for years be able to stop an effective invasion of Taiwan, but China would find very many ways of fighting the conflict by guerrilla tactics,
yeah.
Maybe even by guerrilla tactics within the United States.
Sure.
Not impossible.
Yeah.
I don't believe America would win that sort of war, because I don't believe America would have the stomach for the... I think there'd be too many people in the end who would say, where is America's real interest? Does it rest still in having people killed in this for an Asian cause?
Sure.
Is this a reversion to Vietnam?
Yeah.
And I think Americans who are saying that would all be totally right. So if you then assume that America loses, if you assume that we've been silly enough to participate, we're left as a defeated partner of a discredited superpower which can return to the Western Hemisphere and resume her economic and trade dominance and all the rest without too much fuss or difficulty.
But
we're left in the region, a totally discredited partner of a discredited superpower with a relatively small population. And this isn't something that I think I would be saying publicly, but in those circumstances, doesn't Australia become a prize?
Mm.
How would the rest of Asia look at us?
Yeah.
We wouldn't have a friend in the whole world. A very good relationship which we have with China would obviously have been totally destroyed.
Yeah.
And would Asia start to say, well, some part of our population pressures can be resolved. We've got an empty continent to ourselves.
So have you been raising these questions privately?
I raise these questions privately to try and get people to think.
If we could talk a little bit about kind of building on this, it's like what you've been doing since 1983, and most recently with the Interaction Council. Yeah, you know, unlike some of your successors as Prime Minister, and it's the same with presidents in this country, it's not like you've gone back to the farm, although that may be what you wanted to do, but you've been out there raising issues, bringing groups together, discussing critical issues, actually going to places like Yugoslavia and
rescuing people.
Rescuing people, going to South Africa and dealing with apartheid and being instrumental in getting Nelson Mandela out of jail. It's like, I mean, how do you choose what it is you're going to focus on? Like, what's critical?
Well, I always, even when I was Prime Minister, enjoyed visiting the farm, but my department didn't like me visiting the farm because I used to have a quiet time and I would think, and in those quiet times I would think of a lot of things that gave the department a lot more work to do.
Right.
And that's, but they didn't mind, they were very good because they thought they were doing useful things. I left politics, I left the parliament when I was 53. Now Australia has not been used to young ex-prime ministers,
yeah.
Or relatively young anyway. People have either retired much older or stayed on in parliament and almost seen out their life as a member of parliament. But, you know, so they haven't really wanted to do other things. I suppose I wanted to keep my mind active, and I would have welcomed the opportunity of doing more things in Australia. But whether it was, just didn't work out that way. I think in Australia, corporations have a view that politics is a polluting business. I have the impression in this country that corporations think that somebody with political experience can be useful to them and give them an entree and an understanding of issues which can help that corporation. That view doesn't exist in Australia. So whatever I did to stop myself being only a farmer, was really internationally based. The really interesting things I've been asked to do have nearly all been international. And so a lot of what I did with CARE, establishing CARE Australia, was CARE International asked me if I would help.
Yeah.
And so that's taken quite a long time.
You've been chairman. Right.
I'm chairman of CARE Australia. I was president of CARE International for 5 years, and I've been chairman of CARE Australia really for too long. It's time somebody else.
But with CARE, you went to Yugoslavia and Kosovo, am I?
Well, I had three. CARE Australia was responsible for CARE's programs in Yugoslavia.
Right.
We ran the mission, and we had three people who disappeared for 2 weeks. We didn't know where they were. One thing led to another, and then we had to spend about 8 or 9 months in the end trying to get them out of jail.
Was it a very difficult process of negotiation because you were there dealing?
It was difficult, and especially difficult in the beginning, because our foreign minister had made a statement that referred to Serbs as barbarians. And the first meeting I had with the senior, wasn't the foreign minister, but the senior person in the department, produced this statement and said, if your foreign minister says we're barbarians, why shouldn't we behave like barbarians?
Yeah.
And it took me over an hour to get that statement off the table. I pretended I hadn't seen it.
Yeah.
So I was sure that the foreign minister didn't mean it and all the rest. But it was a question of building up confidence.
Yeah, and building up confidence, building up a trust. Were you able to establish a good relationship?
We had to establish trust with the justice ministers, with the people in the prison system, with the foreign minister, especially, and even with Milosevic. And without that, we would not have got them out of jail.
Yeah,
and it was before we'd had people captured. I'd made a statement heavily criticizing the bombing and the whole origin of the war, not because I thought the Serbs were saints, but because I thought that the West was being partisan in its application of principle.
In what way?
Well, the people we were working with in Serbia were 500,000 Serbs ethnically cleansed out of Ukraine. A senior American official told the Croats, there's going to be a ceasefire shortly, there's going to be a conference at Dayton, you won't be able to do any more ethnic cleansing after that ceasefire takes place. You better get rid of as many Serbs as you can in the next couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Why did the West say that Tudjman could ethnically cleanse Serbs?
Yeah.
It seemed to me that it's an equal crime no matter which way you go about it.
Did you feel an obligation to speak out against that? Because I know you had an article in the International Herald Tribune. You'd made a number of statements against the NATO bombings and Western policy then.
Well, we were getting information back through our employees in Yugoslavia. And I really felt that NATO had gone over the top. I think I was here, certainly here when our people were in jail, but I'm not sure that I wasn't here with Helmut Schmidt when the bombing started.
Yeah.
And you know, Germany very nearly had Helmut taking a very public position against the whole operation. I know he told Schroeder that if ever one German soldier was sent into Kosovo or anywhere else in Yugoslavia, Schmidt will publicly condemn the whole exercise.
Yeah.
He felt very strongly that NATO had perverted its whole mission.
Yeah.
And, you know, people were and should still have been concerned with the geopolitical problems, which is antagonizing the Russians, antagonizing the Chinese, making cooperation much more difficult, and at the same time as pushing NATO to the borders of Russia,
yeah.
Which the Russians have not and are not going to forgive.
Yeah.
They can't do anything about it, but it will certainly influence events in the, well, it has influenced events in the future.
Yeah.
I mean, both Russia and China normalized relations with Serbia, you know, while Milosevic was still there.
So
the real, if I could just make yeah. one other point, the real argument against what NATO had done, and what had also happened, I think, in the Balkans, in Bosnia earlier, is that with the right kind of diplomacy, the bombing and NATO activities extended Milosevic's life and power by 3 years.
Mm.
The demonstrations against Milosevic in Serbia, in Yugoslavia generally, well before the bombing, in the 18 months before that, had been huge, massive, and just as large as the demonstrations that took place when Kostunica was
wow,
put
yeah.
in power. And, but, you know, when they were attacked by 790 million of the world's wealthiest and richest countries,
yeah.
and militarily all the most powerful countries, what could any Serb do? I had a number saying, I loathe Milosevic, but I'm a Serb. What can I do? We have to stand together.
Yeah. And it was, I mean, the PR spin to it all was it was a humanitarian intervention, yet it seemed to produce more humanitarian concerns and consequences.
Well, that I think was a shabby excuse. It wasn't a humanitarian intervention. 92% of the casualties were civilians.
Mm.
Very few military casualties. The military all knew how to defend themselves, or they had misunderstood how Tito had divided the country up into separate, discrete defensive areas, very powerful local regional commanders for each relatively small area, trucks, equipment, petrol, ammunition, all underground, not capable of being bombed.
Yeah.
And because Tito had thought he was going to have to fight off a Russian invasion,
yeah.
and had very thoroughly prepared Serbia as a consequence. But you know, the whole handling of the issue, what was put to Milosevic and to the Albanians, the KLA, at Rambouillet.
Yeah.
No Serb leader, doesn't matter who it would have been, could have accepted the terms.
Yeah.
There was no negotiation about those terms. So there's a strong argument, which I think people have written in foreign policy in this country, that the terms were designed to give an excuse to bomb.
Yeah.
Now, the terms at the end of the war were very significantly different.
Mm.
And so in terms of the so-called peace settlement,
mm.
Milosevic indeed had a substantial victory compared to what was demanded of him. And if the post-war terms had been on the table, I really do believe that he would have signed. The three differences were, at Rambouillet, there'd be a vote in Kosovo 3 years later to determine its status. After the war, NATO agreed that Kosovo was an integral and permanent part of Yugoslavia, which I hope countries will adhere to. At Rambouillet, NATO forces were to have the right to move anywhere throughout the whole of Yugoslavia, at the end of the war, they were to be confined absolutely to the confines of Kosovo. Mm. At Rambouillet, they were to be NATO troops. After the war, they were to wear blue berets. They were three very significant concessions from the point of view of the Serbs. And, you know, it's ironic, because now everyone's asking the Serb army to help them with the KLA problem.
Oh, yeah.
In relation to Macedonia.
Yeah. Was it difficult making the speaking out against that, since NATO was such a apparently strong alliance, and the United States was adamant in its position?
Well, the United States was adamant, and the British were adamant, but there was an awful lot of disconcern in, people whose judgment I respect greatly, like Schmitz, Peter Carrington, all older people, certainly. All of these, in my own instincts, thought that this was a most terrible disaster.
Yeah, yeah.
And when, you know, Tony Blair made a speech in Chicago after the 50th anniversary celebrations for NATO, and he said he wanted Kosovo to be an example of the ethical campaigns that NATO would undertake through this century.
Yeah.
You know, who did you think he was? Richard II or whatever, and re-establishing the Crusades? Why don't they declare war on Turkey?
Yeah.
Because what the Turks have done to their Kurds is probably very, very much worse. They would have killed far more people than have ever been killed in the Balkans. But Turkey's a NATO ally.
Oh, yeah.
So Turkey's allowed to do what it likes to its minorities.
Oh, yeah.
And
you know, I think it would be interesting for people to know how you negotiated with the prison guards, with Milosevic. You had going for you some credibility, since you had spoken out against against the NATO and the American position. So that must have helped you get in the door.
It helped get in the door. The government, our government, had made public statements supporting NATO, and I...
You had to neutralize those.
Well, I neutralized those, and I said, if you go on making these kinds of statements, people are going to be killed, and you'll be responsible, and I went so far as saying I will hold you responsible.
You said privately that you would hold them publicly responsible.
Privately, that I'd hold them publicly responsible if they went on making their statements. And but at the prison, you go to the justice minister. Can we visit the people in prison? Yes, we can visit the people in prison. Visiting the Australians was not all that difficult. And they were in relatively good heart. The one who was in a different prison was the Sir Blanco Jelen, who was one of our employees also. And he had a young wife and a couple of kids in Belgrade. The Serbs made it clear to our ambassador, whom we kept there, yes, you can still behave as though you have consular responsibilities, although they had none. He was a Serb. Yes, Kerr, of course, can visit him. When I went there, I could visit him. And the first time I went to the prison, I said, well, you know, it must be fairly difficult for you with all the sanctions. What are the things that you're shortest of? He said, well, you've seen the clothes the prisoners wear. It gets terribly cold in the winter. Our blankets are worn out and very thin, and some warm clothing is really an absolute essential. And I said, all right, well, we'll arrange some clothing to be sent, and we'll make sure it comes to you and doesn't get distributed somewhere else by somebody in a department. And they said, well, you know, they asked if we could extend our generosity to some medicines, first aid equipment. I said, well, you know, what do you need? And their needs were very simple, very much primary health care, and nothing complex, nothing all that expensive. And so, you know, the prison governor actually was a croat, and he showed me around the prison. It was clean, it looked well kept, the facilities were primitive, as you'd accept or expect, but he obviously had a pride in the way he ran the prison. And you know, then we had to have a Serbian lunch, which often started at 5 o'clock and went on for 2 hours. And I had a Serbian dinner to have also. So we established a good relationship with the prison governor, and that was maintained by the care people in Belgrade. It was maintained by our embassy officials. And, you know, between the governor and the councillor, who was there to, I suppose, help prisoners, people might be surprised that a Serbian prison would have a psychological council to help people who are in distress or whatever. But they did, and this guy, I think, kept Blankoshell alive. There were a number of occasions when the governor rang up our office in Belgrade and said, can you get somebody down to see Blanco? He's feeling pretty low. Can you get his wife to come down? We can organize a couple of extra conjugal visits. Mm-hmm. And they really took, seemed to me anyway, to take a personal interest in making sure that this guy, I don't know any Australian prison where the governor would take the same sort of interest, certainly not the private prisons.
But they had the former Prime Minister of Australia come and have dinner and lunch extended. You invested time that signaled to them that this man was important to you.
Yes, all of that, and they responded to it.
Yes, and they responded.
But if the common perception of Serbs had been accurate, mm-hmm. they wouldn't have responded to it.
Yes, of course.
And, it just shows that demonizing a people can be a very dangerous thing to do if you ever want to have decent or productive relations.
You're a part of the eminent persons group that went to South Africa in 85, was it?
85, 86,
to start to generate a dialogue around the ending of apartheid. What was it like when you went there and started to deal with the belligerent leadership of that country to try to break this up and facilitate the release of Mandela? I mean, was it the end? Was that the agenda? What was the purpose?
Our agenda was really to try and facilitate a dialogue between the government and the ANC. We knew we couldn't resolve it. They had to resolve it in discussions between the two major parties. And South Africa was under increasing economic pressure, and that was important. They were starting to look for ways out.
Yeah.
And they thought they might be able to use us, because they said, all right, we don't mind a dialogue. But they thought that they'd be having a dialogue with 10 dozen, 20 disparate African groups, all having their own agendas, none of them agreeing. And they also thought that with the help of Buthelezi and the homeland leaders, that they'd be able to manipulate that kind of negotiation. But in one sense, we postponed a negotiation, because they learned through us, and you know, there was no way this could have been avoided, but they learned through us that they weren't going to be faced with a number of disparate African groups in a negotiation. They would be faced with a solid African position, Mandela at the forefront, supported even by Buthelezi. I mean, he told us very clearly he'd obviously support Mandela. And therefore, the government came to realize, well, this is going to be a real negotiation. This is going to be a tough negotiation. There's no guarantee that we can get out of that negotiation what we would like. And it was that realization that stopped the negotiation taking place almost immediately after our visits.
Yeah.
And it was another couple of years before they came to realize, and you know, it was the transformation of de Klerk, which is, Mandela couldn't have done it without de Klerk.
Yeah.
Or with somebody like de Klerk, who, the way he himself changed, and the way he changed 95% of the National Party, well, it was quite extraordinary.
Yeah.
Did you play a role in that with him in your discussions?
Well,
his learning and his change.
The first time I met de Klerk, I was only scheduled to be with him for about 20 minutes. I ended up being there for about 3 hours. And he wanted to demonstrate to me that he was right, they were right. And so it all started with persecution in Holland, the voyage to the Cape, the Great Trek, and all the difficulties, the Zulu Wars, how they established their own circumstances. And then the British arrived. And it wasn't the Nazis, Mr. Fraser. It was the English who established concentration camps and murdered our women and children. In one sense, that's true. The only real question, to which I don't know the answer, is did the British comprehend that establishing those camps without adequate clean water and sanitation would lead to tens of thousands of deaths? Was that inadvertent or was it deliberate? It was probably inadvertent, but I think the jury's really out on that question. Anyway, all of this historic lecture ended up with de Klerk saying to me, "So you see, Mr. Fraser, why we will never again allow our political future to be determined by any other group or any other race." And you know, they really, they only won their freedom in 1948.
Yeah, it's pretty recent.
They've been a subject people up to that point.
Yeah.
Because South Africa with Smuts was going in directions they didn't like and didn't want. If they had been an authority, South Africa would have been on Germany's side in the war.
Yeah.
Smuts, only by the grace of God, was able to put it in on the side of the Allies.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the transformation of de Klerk, who had, he was the thinker amongst the South African government. P.W. Botha was impossible. And in the end, it was his own people who got rid of him. But
it was important in your first conversation with de Klerk to listen to the story, wasn't it?
Oh, yes.
You had to listen to the story to begin to develop a relationship.
Had to listen to his story. We had to listen to P.W. Botha. We had to listen to Pick Botha, who would have been for change much earlier, but he didn't have authority or support in the South African government. But there were a number of people, they weren't going to say it to us, and they weren't going to break solidarity, but there were a number of people who already believed that there had to be change.
Number of people in South Africa, yeah. In the white government.
People in the hotel we were in, people had come up to me and say, are you Fraser, are you with the Commonwealth Group? Yes. What's the chances of success, how it's going? And I'd say, who are you? And sometimes they'd have an English name, but more often than not, they'd have an Afrikaans name.
Yeah.
So, you know, across the spectrum of South African society, there were people who were wanting a...
Yeah.
Did you have subsequent conversations with de Klerk that you felt more effectiveness in his intellectual development, in his emotional development?
In the last meeting we had with them is one after which I think they'd clearly made the decision that there would not be a negotiation at that time. And de Klerk and they went and bombed places in Zimbabwe and not Zimbabwe, in Botswana and somewhere else where the ANC had been holding up or had their sort of offshore headquarters. In those visits, de Klerk didn't show much sign of flexibility.
He
would sometimes ask quite thoughtful questions, but he wasn't going to put himself apart.
Exposed, yeah.
Wasn't going to expose himself as being apart from the rest. Even Pik Botha wouldn't do that. There was an interesting moment with Pik Botha when the common talk had it that his, as is true with a lot of Afrikaners, that his genes were not as pure Afrikaans as they might have wanted them to be. And Tony Barber at one point in a gap in the discussion said, "Minister, you would make a very good black president." We didn't know, Tony Barber didn't know what the gossip was, but I knew, and I thought, Jesus, you know, is Pick going to walk out or is he going to make a joke of it? There was silence for about a minute, then he made a joke of it.
Now, eventually you actually got in to see Nelson Mandela in prison.
Yeah, right? I saw him in prison twice.
What was that experience like? I mean, personally, to be there with a man who'd been incarcerated for, 25, 7 years, whatever it was, and there you are, and you're his link in some way to the larger world and the possibility of freedom.
Well, part of it was telling him what we were doing. We were obviously telling him about the discussions we'd had with the government, discussions we'd had with the ANC.
Yeah.
We would have made the point that if there are going to be negotiations, it's not only the government, but the ANC will have to make concessions.
Yeah.
The principal one of which was to suspend violence. There were a lot of people who argued, no, that won't be good enough, it's got to be forswear any future violence. And I said, that's unreasonable, you're not going to get them to do that.
Yeah. Did he understand the logic of your position?
He would understand that. He was very quick.
Yeah.
He'd understand the logic of that, absolutely. It was people on the government side who would have wanted them to say they'll put down violence for all time.
Right.
Say, you know, if you're going to do that, you're going to go on having violence forever because they won't do it.
You described him last night as one of the great leaders that you admire.
Mm.
What is it that you do admire about him, just by virtue of observing him in recent years?
Well, by virtue of his achievements, but more particularly the kind of man he is. There's never a thought of retribution in his mind or in his heart. There had to be reconciliation. People had to get on together. He was obviously highly respected by his jailers. They were, in fact, his friends. And that might have helped to keep his sanity, because if you're shut up and remote with nobody to talk to, it's better to talk to your jailer if you can have a conversation with him than nobody.
Yeah.
And if he had, in a cold-blooded way, tried to work out how can he have most influence when he gets out, he could have come to the same conclusion. I must show no hatred, I must show a sense of generosity, I must talk about the future, I must talk and act about reconciliation. But I don't think it's something he did come to by cold-blooded analysis. I think it was the basic instinct of the man that made him believe that this was the way to behave, or the way he wanted to behave.
Yeah.
And it's the most important thing which sets Mandela aside, I think, was his attitude of mind.
Yeah.
And how he operated, and how he achieved support and trust. He never made an inflammatory statement when he came out. He could so easily have done it.
Yeah, it wouldn't have taken much to ignite whatever sparks of fires were there.
He did express anger of injustice and outrage with injustice.
Oh yes, he did, but he always did it in measured terms. He never did it in a way that so inflamed people, you know, people started to go off and take injustice into the, take justice into their own hands. And
well, our time is up, and for the next 20 years, are you still going to continue kind of working these issues and concerns on internationally?
Well, what I'm really trying to do is to clear my desk so I can work out what I want to do with the rest of my life.